I'm Hirokazu Miyazaki, director of the Mario Einaudi Center for International Studies and also professor of anthropology here at Cornell University. As we continue to mourn the loss of President Elizabeth Garrett, today's event reminds me of her spirited encouragement for me and the Einaudi Center to tackle global sustainability issues. As we all know, she was an inspiring leader and a champion of international studies. I still take to heart her call in her inauguration speech for us to continue to be radical and progressive. Today, we commemorate the fifth anniversary of Japan's earthquake, tsunami, and nuclear disaster at Fukushima Daiichi. Nearly 19,000 people died or are still missing, and over 200,000 were displaced. But as many of you know, the disaster is far from over. The troubled reactors are still not completely under control, and Japan is still struggling with a multitude of crises either emanating from or amplified by this event. Early in the development of nuclear power, advocates predicted that the electricity produced would be too cheap to meter. One thing that the Fukushima disaster has told us is that nuclear energy is anything but cheap, especially if something goes wrong. The cost of the multiple meltdowns at Fukushima is not yet known. In fact, it is only beginning to be articulated in lawsuits and other efforts to take measure the precise the damage and the cost of the disaster. In a calculation recently made by Kenichi Oshima, professor of international relations at Ritsumeikan University and the author of the award-winning book The Cost of Nuclear Energy, the amount of compensation paid by TEPCO, the operator of the power plant, is likely to surpass 6 trillion yen, or $53 billion. But that comes nowhere near the true cost of the disaster. The damage includes not just the destruction of infrastructure and livelihoods, but also long-term health effects, which may take decades to understand, and intangibles like the loss of homeland and of everyday normalcy. Today, many of Japan's nuclear power plants remain shut. Just 2 days ago, the Otsu District Court in Shiga Prefecture near Kyoto delivered an unprecedented decision requiring Kansai Electric Power Company to stop the operation of reactors at Takahama Nuclear Power Plant that were just restarted earlier this year. But despite all this, despite all the expense and uncertainty, the government of Japan still sees nuclear power as an important part of the country's energy future. Clearly, energy policy isn't just a question of financial cost and risk. It is also linked to a whole range of other policy issues, from national security to trade. China's rise and North Korea's continuing nuclear threat has rekindled discussion about Japan's ostensibly secret desire to possess nuclear weapons. Concerns about national defense are linked, often implicitly, but sometimes explicitly, to the need to restart many nuclear reactors. Japanese companies are also actively competing with China, France, and Russia in the global market for nuclear energy. These companies have strongly supported the government's arguments for restarting Japan's own reactors. So what lessons can we learn from Japan's struggle to come to terms with the future of nuclear energy? I would argue that many are specific to Japan, having to do with the way the nuclear industry has been regulated, the way the so-called nuclear village, a tight-knit group of industry professionals, academic experts, and regulators has operated, the way power companies have been financed, the way courts have worked vis-a-vis business and political interests, and the way citizens' activism has been organized. Maybe that is the most important lesson, not just from what happened at Fukushima 5 years ago, but also at Three Mile Island in 1979 and Chernobyl in 1986. That is, that we need to understand these disasters in their specific historical, social, technical, political, and organizational contexts. We can thank the three distinguished scholars assembled here today for their groundbreaking work in exploring, exposing, and explaining these specifics. For it is only through deep knowledge of the particulars that we can begin to tackle the complex general question of whether nuclear energy has a future in the world, or whether the world can imagine a future with nuclear energy. It is my pleasure to introduce Professor Kiyoshi Kurokawa, who will launch this roundtable discussion with a brief keynote address. A physician by training, Professor Kurokawa chaired the Fukushima Nuclear Accident Independent Investigation Commission from December 2011 to July 2012. He's currently adjunct professor at the National Graduate Institute for Policy Studies, Tokyo, Japan, and Professor Emeritus of Medicine at the University of Tokyo. He previously was Professor of Medicine at UCLA and the University of Tokyo. He also served as the Dean of the School of Medicine at Tokai University. From 2003 to 2006, he served as President of the Science Council of Japan. Professor Kurokawa has received numerous awards and honors, including the Order of the Rising Sun, the Gold and Silver Star from the Japanese government in 2011, and the Scientific Freedom and Responsibility Award from the American Association for the Advancement of Science. He was also named one of the 100 top global thinkers by the Foreign Policy magazine in 2011. Please join me in welcoming Professor Kurokawa.
This shows the website NAIIC.net, so you can see that anytime. This is... just listen to it.
The nuclear accident in Fukushima shocked the world. How could this have happened in a country so famous for its advanced technology? The circumstances of this disaster must be thoroughly investigated, and the lessons learned passed down to future generations. But that's no easy task. Tokyo Electric Power Company, or TEPCO, and the Japanese government have carried out their own investigations, but both were directly involved in the accident, TEPCO as the plant operator and the government as the responder, so their objectivity and independence have to be questioned. That is why the Japanese parliament, which represents the people, decided to establish an independent commission to investigate the accident. While this is a standard procedure in most other countries, it is the first independent commission ever to be created in the history of Japan. The 10 commissioners and their staff were independent from the government and from TEPCO. Each of them had different opinions about nuclear power. The commission was called the Nuclear Accident Independent Investigation Commission, or NAIIC. It was given greater legal powers than any other entity investigating the accident. Chairman Kiyoshi Kurokawa defined three principles for the investigation. 1. To adopt the people's point of view. 2. To share the findings with all other countries. And 3. To submit recommendations for the future. After conducting more than 900 hours of hearings, 1,167 interviews, and 2,000 requests for documents to TEPCO, regulators, and relevant parties, the NAIIC produced a 592-page report. This video explains the essence of that report.
Thank you. This is an introduction of our reports. First time in the constitutional democratic Japan and commissioned by the parliament. And I think we have, we are just given this mandate, which effectively by law in the end of September of that year and started in December 8th of the same year. Now, so that is the story. This series is a six-part series of every video clips is about 3 minutes. And this was created by student volunteers after we just submitted this thing, and they read through it and just studied the extra and created this animation. And this was originally in Japanese, but I think they developed also English version. But I think making this animation into this Japanese character, Chinese character, is too much for the work, so that they just put on this label, on this English, but narrator become English. All right, so I'd like to review with you the lesson of Fukushima nuclear accident, and that's me, and this I'm really grateful to Dr. Miyazaki-san and others to invite me for this occasion and share this lesson with you. Let's see. Now, many severe sort of black swan events tend to happen over the last decade or so, and that started in 21st century, 9/11. You remember 9/11, what happened in the first year of this century. Everybody remembers, particularly in the US, in this East Coast, but that was the first of my birthday of the new century. So many remembers me, so that I think I get many emails on my birthday. Congratulations on this thing. But now, what's in this August 15th of this 2008, that's a Lehman shock that affected the entire financial institution of the world. That is one of the globalization and connectivity. And then what happened in 2010, December 18th, which is just 3 months preceding Fukushima accident and Tohoku disaster. That was the beginning of Arab Spring in Cartagena. So that means after these 3 months prior to Fukushima, what kind of change we are seeing now in the world? Northern part of Africa is gone, sort of, and Middle East affecting, and then all of a sudden Syrian refugee things, which is impacting a lot in Europe right now. We are not so sure, so many things are happening. But have we seen any significant change in Japanese sort of governance, corporate governance, even seeing the Toshiba scandal, all the things? That is 3/11, March 11th, which is 5 years ago. And then November the 13th, last year, you may remember, that's a massacre in Paris by sort of Islamic States. And that was a Friday. I was in the airplane between Vancouver, University of British Columbia, to Toronto. Just when I arrived in Toronto, everything on this massacre in Paris. That could happen anytime, anywhere. Now, this is a Tohoku disaster, and many in the world watch this thing and live in flat TV, in color, live. So that had a lot of impact. Maybe 10, 20 years ago, you may not have seen this thing, but many people in the world watch this and watch this briefing by the government and TEPCO almost every day, although these are done in Japanese. I think that will be translated right away in different languages, and everybody begin to see within a week, Japanese government and TEPCO are hiding something. You just cannot hide it in this connected world. Now, this happens only 1 hour after this tsunami hitting, and that was really startled everybody watching this thing. Now, so that this independent commission was enacted, and just because this is the fifth year, I just published a book on this story of the Fukushima accident, why this commission was created, my role was there, how I assembled the team, and how to deliver this thing, how we did that. And I think the response of the world and in Japan after this accidental report, and why I did that kind of thing. That book just appeared yesterday, and it's Japanese. You can search on the Amazon. I just brought 3 copies to them. But I plan to publish this in English too. Right now, we started also translation right now. maybe publishing by Cornell University Press, perhaps that is an option. All right. Now, so just as I said, I think I started with this when I given this mandate by the parliament. This is on the video. You can see that in December 8th, and also just in the excerpt in the National Diet record. And just I made a three keywords I like to just carry this commission was people and the future and the world. And this I said on the record, you can see that. I like to see this commission, first time in the constitutional democratic Japan. I consider this commission is a commission of the people, by the people, and for the people, reminding them what kind of sort of fundamental of democracy. And for future means to make some future sort of recommendation to the parliament, and we had to study the past. Otherwise, it's become irrelevant. So that's what we did. And the world, sharing with the world so that we could learn this thing, and also incorporating, asking some wisdom and suggestions by the world affair how to mend this sort of accident. And so that's what it is. Now, what we did, and this mandate was within 6 months. So that was a very difficult thing, because first time, and who would be working with us? You know, many Japanese may be full-time, cannot come from TEPCO. There may be some of the spies may be coming. How to recruit our staff? That was one of the first questions. I think I really struggled this thing. But at least at the end, we had 20 commission meetings with 38 key peoples, chairman and many political leaders. And you can see that. And 900 hours of hearing with more than 1,000 sort of people, politicians and TEPCO and also sufferers, 9 nuclear power plants visit, 3 overseas visit. I led a visit to US, like Washington DC, DOD and FEMA and many people, the NRC and the Academy too, and went to see somewhere. I forgot the name, in South Carolina, where the GE nuclear headquarters was there. We visited this, and CEO's a reasonably young woman, very impressed, and also Chattanooga, Tennessee, to see the training center for nuclear operators. That was also very interesting to see. Evacuation survey and on-site working survey of workers and town meeting, over 400 attendees. All the commission meeting broadcasted live and online with simultaneous English translation. So you can see that, NAIIC and GO and JP, GOJP. You can see that. And also press briefing after each session, also that broadcasted. So any question by the press, you can value what kind of thing they are stupid or just very, piercing questions. I told them, press, your question is already on the record for the rest of your life. And the core message of this night turned out to be the regulatory capture. And this is a collusion by TEPCO and this and that. And that regulatory capture, the one of the economic theory advanced by George Sigler of the University of Chicago, which led him to have a Nobel Prize in the economics. And so that happens everywhere. But we are addressing, is there any factors in Japanese society which may be more conducive to regulatory capture. So that was the case in analysis. In fact, David Pilling was head of the Financial Times Tokyo office in year 2002 to 2008, and he really likes Japan, so he just studied a lot on Japan during his tenure in Tokyo. But now he moved to Hong Kong as the head of Financial Times Asia Pacific. So he just come often, quite often. And he published a book, Bending Adversity, Japan and the Art of Survival. And he just interviewed many people while he was in Tokyo. But after this 3/11 accident, he just came to Japan quite often he continued to study on his research. But he published this book in chapter 14, year 2014. Chapter 14 focuses on Fukushima accident. And this story go around our story, our report, and also op-ed to Financial Times about 10 days later, criticizing our report is not accusing anyone, and this is made in Japan, and this is Japanese culture. That was our message, so that they just Gerald Curtis, who is a sort of Columbia University expert professor at Japanese politics, but I think he just made a op-ed to Financial Times claiming our research, our paper, is not accusing any specific person, which is that means nobody is responsible. But I argue that is a different thing. And in fact, David Pilling just wrote this thing, accident exposed in a flash, quite literally, the worst trait of all Japan, with its elitist and secretive bureaucratic culture, he just pointed out. And if you read this thing, he really supports and gets my core message. You know, everybody as an individual or a member of any institution, you have to be more responsible and just think for the future, just what you have to do and what you have to say. So I just, so that thing. So I think in my view, I think there's a certain factor in Japan which lead to this collusion. That's a part of a Japanese trait or societal norm. So that was sort of my argument. And in fact, utility company in Japan is about their 10 utility company. Teco is the largest. And every utility company has a monopoly in the regional distribution and production of energy, electricity. And monopoly always lead to some collusion, right? I never see any monopoly in the history of humans which never become sort of out of perfect. So that is an impression of my Japanese society. For example, this is a fairly sort of, do you see this kind of thing? If you know enough about Japanese friend, for example, like Mitsubishi, somebody who works for Mitsubishi Bank, you never heard of somebody move to Sumitomo Bank. Why is that? Engineers in Hitachi never moved to Toshiba. Why is that? How about Asahi Shimbun journalists? Are they moving to Yomiuri? No. Why is that? Why this is a norm in Japan? In this country, you work as an engineer in Hitachi or somewhere, GE, can't you move to some other company? You could do that. And once you're in what one ministry, Minister of Education, Health, or whatever ministry, fresh out of college, you stay there for the rest of your career. That is a norm and the perception by majority of Japanese. Strange. But that is really built in Japanese psyche. So that means you just, any institution or society at large tend to be seniority-based, belong to the one sort of Mitsubishi Bank. So that means you cannot move. If you do move, then you'll be sort of alienated by Japanese sort of societal pressure. And so that seniority-based promotion become a norm. Why is it? That's strange. But that's what the thing that's become very conducive to not raising the voices and conformity a norm, even from kindergarten. So this is really encouraging not to make a noises in your institution. So that is the underground sort of background of even Toshiba, Olympus for 5 years. That's what it is. All right. Is there any society in the world? I'm telling bureaucrats, once you are in, somehow, who is the head of this each ministry? I mean, that's crazy. So there's no such country. So that's it. So the mindset of Japanese tend to be groupthink, because with, you know, same group of people, and not talking any different opinions. And transparency and openness is still lacking. Do you see Japanese government and TEPCO are really trying to ask your advice, any advice, or just make it their data open so that they are welcome any new ideas, input, or criticism, whatever that may be. So lack of transparency and openness, and groupthink is the prevailing norm. Lack of sense of accountability, even in Japanese, accountability is translated into, do you know what is the Japanese meaning of accountability? Setsume sekini. They are translated accountability into responsibility to explain. Explanation is not enough. I mean, that's a completely typical one of lost in translation. So even Japanese media and everything, they say, setsume sekini, responsibility to explain. If that is the case, that's an easy job to be an executive. or senior government official. Obligation dissent is not really a norm. If your child, it tend to be a more out-of-box saying, even in the garden, even kindergarten, there's a lot of pressure not to do that from the parents. So that's a typical mindset of Japanese. In fact, the title of my book, which published yesterday, is the title of book is Regulatory Capture, Groupthink Can Kill Japan. So that's the subtitle. All right. In response to our report, there are many reports and investigative journalistic papers have been appeared on Fukushima accident. But Richard Samuels, perhaps some of you may know, he is a professor at MIT. His expertise in Japanese politics. He wrote a book, 311, year 2013, and the book at the conclusion, and the title of the book is 311, Disaster and Change in Japan. And his conclusion is, little sign of changing policy-making process and democracy in Japan. So the conclusion is, what kind of this disaster Japan is really needed to change? So that's his message. And Government Accountability Office in USA also published a paper on Fukushima thing, year 2014. And I think they really addressed safety culture is a very important element of nuclear safety, but why Japanese are something is not really missing there. And 1 week later, IAEA, first time in the history, organized 3 days workshop addressing IAEA recommendation and safety culture and national culture. Because even they recommend safety recommendation, Japan has not implemented defense in depth recommendation by IAEA. Because I think the IAEA people asked Japanese government, why you're not implementing this? And their answer was, some sort of civil servant and expert from Japanese community said, well, we assume there's no severe accident in Japan. That's what I was told after I delivered this report. So everybody in that nuclear sort of community in the world knew Japanese lack of this implementing this defense in depth, so assuming there's no accident, severe accident. All right, so that's IAEA. So the IAEA first time had a workshop on safety culture and national sort of culture. And that was, but I was not invited, not informed, of course. So my friend and they just attended, and there are three people representing Japan. So they asked the representing delegates, why Dr. Kuroka is not here? And they are frozen because somebody ordered them to come. So that's what it is. So they sent me an email, somehow you are not invited, you didn't know anything. So that's the connected world, scary thing. National Academy of USA also mandated National Academy for 2 years study on the Fukushima accident, what US can learn from it. That's more like technological engineering aspect. That started August of 2012. That means 1 month after we delivered this paper. And the chairman of National Academy, chairman was Dr. Neureiter, Norman Neureiter, who was the first chief science advisor to the State Department, which began in year 2000. And we have been friends, so he sent me an email. I'm studying this, but your report was just like me, very, very clear, straightforward report. That's what. Then 2 years later, he came to just brief Japanese government on this thing, but I think he also came to visit me because he asked the Japanese government through perhaps Japanese government in Washington, D.C. for all the tour or appointment, but they didn't include me. Of course, they didn't know. This is the first time. They delivered it or not, I'm not so sure. So he came one day earlier by himself, and we had a meeting. Wonderful. And David Peering's book I showed you. So lesson learned from NIAC, apparent cause of insufficient defense in depth that had been revealed, and lack of systematic knowledge management and transfer, and lack of safety consciousness, and regulatory and academic capture, including media, too. And let's see, that's what it is. And also, I think after 9/11, US government has an exhaustive investigation and of 9/11 incidents, and nuclear plant could be a good target of terrorist attack. so that they have a different recommendation to every 100 nuclear plant here, and they have a briefing twice with the Japanese government how to augment their safety and prevention for potential terrorist attack, but they never implemented anything. So that has been revealed after this many studies of the Fukushima accident. But the root cause, according to us, a lack of learning and questioning attitude of Japan. Do they have it? Are they asking you for any advices? Poorly developed safety culture, complacence and mindset, and closed monocultured community and groupthink. Responsibility of Japan in the world, it's a reasonably large economy, and which is a sort of earned a reputation of excellence in science and technology and also innovation and also industrial manufacturing, but this happened in Japan. Active, open-minded, bi- and multilateral communication with international partners, they should do that. And lesson learned, sharing, attitude, openness, and inviting any sort of advices, do you feel that? Decommissioning process, why not ask? Contaminated water, why not ask? In fact, they asked for open bidding for this contaminated water thing, and they have 750 applications for suggestions, and about 200 of those from abroad. But have they revealed all the proposals? And how to make this many proposals to develop actual practical solution for time and technology and cost? But they have not done that. So that's a crazy thing. New Nuclear Safety Agency has been established. A commissioner, head of commissioner was Dr. Tanaka-san, but they have about 900 sort of civil servants and academics under his office. But again, each sort of civil servant from each ministry has tied with their own ministry. Our recommendation was no return rule, but they just don't do that, of course. And other matters, the future perspective reflecting Fukushima nuclear accident like this and sharing with the world. That is the responsibility of the Japanese government and auto industry. Nobody wants to see the same thing again. So Japan viewed from the world, positive, stable business operation, hardworking engineers, well-trained operators, skillful technicians, well-informed, reasonably well-informed public, but I think media was a part of captured and press club, all the things. Is not really useful at the moment, and negative is unclear decision-making process, nobody takes any responsibility, and isolated clothes from international community, and governance is show a strong loyalty to something, and weak leadership and lack of sense of accountability. Now, just for your interest, there are certain elements of Japanese culture mindset, which is written by many, and I guess one is the most important, Ruth Benedict, which wrote about Japanese culture, Chrysanthemum and the Sword, 1948. And she recommended what kind of governance body Americans should implement. And I think that was a very well studied, although she's not an expert in Japanese, but I think she did a really great job. And then Nakane Chie is only one member of National Academy woman who just really wrote about Japan society in Japanese, 72 in English, and accompanies paper is Japan and Dynamics of Virtual Society. That is not in English, but I think she is very well known in this Japanese culture mindset. And so, and also Ivan Hall, Culture of the Mind, Japanese intellectual clothes shop. That means he spent like 20 years in academics, and he just find out Japanese mindset is very, very close, even very intellectual community, like academic, universities, research community, and also lawyers community, even media, and why they just try not to include, invite non-Japanese. And Samuel Huntington, Crash of Civilization, the Remaking World Order, that's also, Japan is very unique, and there's no country to share Japanese sort of mindset. And Carl Wolfen, Enemy of Japanese Power, that's a rising Japanese economy, and he wrote a nice book about Japan. Nobody takes any responsibility. If you contact somebody, nobody has any sort of responsibility and decision-making process. So I think he wrote this in English because I think now Japan is rising, so everybody wants to come to Japan, negotiate, but he wants to educate and non-Japanese people because he spent so many years in Japan. Eiko Ikegami is a fantastic, she's also New York City University. She also the Taming of the Samurai, and also Bond of Civility. This is a very thick books, but that's very insightful. John Dower's Embracing Defeat is also another very famous bestseller in this country. And Richard Summers, I just introduced to you. And David Fring, I just commented on you. He's a FTA headquarter. And Tagad Murphy, who was also likes Japan, he lives in Japan. He, 2 years ago, also 2014, published a book, Japan and the Shackle of the Past, Why Japanese Mindset is Something Like That. This is, I think, if you want to know more about Japanese culture and mindset, just this is some suggestion. Okay, so I plan to have a lunch with Mr. Murphy, who now teaches at Tsukuba University, next week over lunch. Thank you. This is just an introduction how unique Japanese tend to be, and I think which is a good thing about Japan, but sometimes good thing become a very weakness of Japan. And in fact, I see many friends from China and India, and they told me, Japan is fantastic, Tokyo great. So even Russia, if I go to Tokyo Station, everybody on the escalator on the left side, is that any rules or regulation? No, I said, no, they do that. If you go to Osaka, that's been on the right side. Is there any rules? No, somehow. So they conform and just educated to conform. And that was the thing. So that kind of conformity may be a strength in certain times, but that become a weakness over the time. So we had to recognize strengths become a weakness on a certain occasion. So thank you very much for coming to this seminar.
Professor Kurokawa, I now like to ask Rebecca Slayton, who is an assistant professor in the Department of Science and Technology Studies and also a core member of the REPI Institute for Peace and Conflict Studies. And I would ask her to introduce the other two speakers before we assemble here for a roundtable discussion.
Thank you. All right. Thank you very much, Professor Kurokawa. That was really informative. I'm delighted to introduce our next speaker, Professor Charles Perrow. He is an emeritus professor of sociology at Yale and an organizational theorist who is widely recognized for his work on nuclear power and complex technological organizations, among other areas. He's the author of over 50 articles, and three of his six books have won awards, including Normal Accidents, Living with High-Risk Technologies, which was published in 1984 about the meltdown at Three Mile Island, The AIDS Disaster, The Failure of Organizations in New York and the Nation, published in 1990 with Mauro Gillian, and Organizing America, Wealth, Power, and the Origins of American Capitalism, published in 2002. He's received numerous other awards and honors, but I don't want to take away from his time, so I'll just welcome him to come deliver his remarks. Thank you.
The major question I have and will speak to is why are we still building nuclear power plants after three major accidents and after demonstrations that they are very expensive, and we now have renewable energy in the form of wind and solar and geothermal that can replace this very dangerous, very expensive production of electric power. And the Fukushima accident might have closed all these efforts to keep on building these things down, but they certainly didn't. And why not? Well, it was one reason is given. It was a unique event. It's really kind of wild to have both one of the largest earthquakes ever and the largest tsunami coming a little under an hour later to these plants. And so that we can defend again. You won't have that very often. The builders of the Fukushima site were responsible for lowering the hill on which the nuclear plants, the six nuclear plants, were put a great deal in order to save money on pumping water from the ocean in order to cool the plants. And so they made it much more exposed to a possible tsunami. Of course, did things like putting the generators in the basement where they would be flooded. A nearby plant, about 30 miles or 50 miles away, had the same exposure to the earthquake and the tsunami as Fukushima, but they hadn't chiseled away the hill. And so they sat high enough so that neither the earthquake nor the tsunami bothered them. Nice lesson there. But another lesson we should take from it is that it wasn't the tsunami. The tsunami caused most of the trouble, but we were likely to have a meltdown even without a tsunami, because after the earthquake took place, the radiation alarms suddenly went on the Fukushima site, especially at unit number one, and the operators testified that there was broken pipes inside the reactor vessel. And so we might have had a huge problem even without the tsunami. As a matter of fact, 14 plants in Japan were damaged, some of them quite seriously, from the earthquake. They didn't have tsunamis. So the Japanese experience should still lead us away from nuclear power, because even earthquakes can do a great deal of damage. But why do we have something like 67 by one estimate, 80 by another estimate, nuclear plants being built in the world today? Why this mad rush, a nuclear renaissance with all these dangers and with the cheapness of solar and wind power showing? I think there's two major issues involved. One is nuclear power plants generate something that's very valuable for states for safety's sake. They generate plutonium. If you have plutonium, you can have a nuclear weapon. And you have to keep generating it. Plutonium, because you keep expanding, because they keep expanding their number of bombs or weapons they want to have available. So that's a good reason for doing this. In the case of Japan, why is it opening up its plants again? They don't have a nuclear bomb. Don't show any strong signs of wanting to build one. However, it is admitted, but not publicized, that having nuclear power plants makes them one step closer to having nuclear weapons in their arsenal. So the Japanese ministries are quite concerned about keeping nuclear power going to generate plutonium and make the transition to a weapon considerably quicker. Okay, that's the first reason, states. And the evidence that states are pro-nuclear is pretty obvious. But in the case of Japan, I'll just mention one. When we started having reporters and the press covered Fukushima more closely, they were turning up things that were embarrassing to the government. Actually, the commission's report that was referred to was embarrassing enough. But they in 2015, Japanese Parliament passed a secrets law, which allows the Japanese government to imprison, to put in prison any journalists who divulge unwanted, unapproved information about Fukushima and its effect. So we have a secrecy law, and in effect, they really want to keep things quiet there. Are we going to learn from the lessons? No, because we're not going to get the teaching that ordinarily you would get on the cancer rate among, a thyroid cancer rate among children and so forth. So they keep it quiet. The U.S. Does so also, and certainly Russia did with Chernobyl. So the second reason, I think, is an economic one. These are very expensive, huge, complicated plants that take from 5 to 15 years to build, and they have contractors from all over the world involved. Toshiba owns Westinghouse, and Westinghouse builds these plants. Areva in France, GE in America. These are big, powerful corporations, and they do not really want to see wind and solar take off, because they don't own it. It's not centralized. It's not terribly profitable. It's a cheap shot. You pay a little bit for solar panels and get on the grid. Nobody's going to make much money at that except a few solar panel makers. However, if you have nuclear power plants in your future, that's big money, big expense. And those companies are very powerful. At least they're powerful in Japan, and they're powerful in the U.S., and I suspect so in France, although I've not investigated that. So we have people who are economically concerned about building more nuclear plants, and we have states, that is, governments, that are in, want more nuclear power plants for defense reasons. It's going to be very hard to come up against that. And let me stop there. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor Perrow. I am now very pleased to welcome our third speaker, Professor Sonja Schmid, who is an associate professor at the Department of Science and Technology and Society at Virginia Tech, at the Northern Virginia campus. She very recently published a book on the development of the civilian nuclear industry in the Soviet Union. It's entitled Producing Power, the Pre-Chernobyl History of the Soviet Nuclear Industry, published by MIT Press in 2015. It's based on extensive archival research in Russia and on interviews with nuclear experts in Russia. She's fluent in Russian, so that's a huge advantage in her ability to write this book. She's also won the very prestigious National Science Foundation Career Award, which is enabling her current research into the challenges of globalizing nuclear emergency response. As part of this grant, she's been organizing monthly seminar series on interdisciplinary research and education in nuclear emergency response. So I hope we'll hear a little bit about her research today. Thank you.
Thank you, Rebecca, and thank you, Professor Miyazaki, for the invitation to come here. I'm very honored to be part of this distinguished panel. In the interest of time, I'll be very brief, and I want to say a few words on Chernobyl and lessons learned or not learned from Chernobyl. So first of all, and inspired by Professor Perrow's normal accidents approach, I think we cannot look, and nobody has done this, but I'm just reiterating this, we cannot look at a nuclear disaster in isolation. It's always part of a complex socio-technical system that encompasses a lot of factors that interact in very specific and, in the case of an accident, unfortunate ways. The other caution I wanted to mention is that there's a tendency among the, especially in the technical community, to focus on the immediate time frame preceding the accident. So that tsunami hit and then what happened. But as we've already heard in the presentation, in the keynote presentation, there is a longer historical, organizational, political, economic, and cultural history leading up to these disasters that we need to understand better to hopefully prevent these disasters or at least respond to them more effectively in the future. So very briefly on Chernobyl, and this is something that you will see in pretty much any disaster response, I would say. There's three main explanations that are mounted, not necessarily in this order, but typically in this order. The first one being human error. These were operators, and usually not the top operators, but someone in the control room or someone on the buttons who actually messed up and made a mistake and triggered this accident. And the consequence of that is in Chernobyl was that six people, three of them senior management at the Chernobyl nuclear power plant, were tried in a semi-public trial a year after the accident and were sentenced to 10 years in labor camp. Now, it's kind of interesting to imagine that three people, three random managers at a nuclear power plant, if you really think of the big picture, could be responsible for the worst at that time civilian nuclear accident to date. But that's exactly what happened. The second argument that usually comes up is there were design flaws. There was something wrong with the technology. At Chernobyl, this was very easy. This argument was very easy to make from Western states, and that indeed it was made. This reactor that exploded at Chernobyl was uniquely Soviet. It could have never happened here because we don't have these reactors, we don't run these reactors, and therefore, it could never happen here, so we don't have to worry about it. I think this is also a trap because we miss the opportunity to understand why a specific design choice, whether it was uniquely Soviet, whether it was uniquely American, whether it was uniquely Japanese, made sense at the time and why it made good sense at the time when it was chosen. Because it did. In the Soviet Union, this design definitely made sense at a time. Otherwise, the Soviets wouldn't have built numerous reactors of that kind next to cities, big cities, urban centers that they hold dear, such as St. Petersburg, for example. And then the third explanation that often follows is the systems explanation, or the kind of a cultural explanation, as we heard in the keynote earlier, where a nation is blamed for a particular mindset, or as in the Soviet Union was the case, the system was blamed for being corrupt and dysfunctional and what have you. But again, I want to remind us that these systems and these cultures worked, and the mechanisms that hold these cultures together, that make up these economic systems or political systems, they work in their own way. And so dismissing them in retrospect is an easy way out, I would say. It's much more difficult to understand how human factors, design issues, and the systemic factor, regulatory capture, etc., interacted in unique and specific ways to trigger this disaster. And in terms of looking forward, going forward and anticipating future disasters, I think Fukushima was, as unfortunate as it was, for a student of Chernobyl like myself, it was very encouraging because all of a sudden, this was a disaster that could not easily be dismissed as something that happened in a country that was corrupt, with operators that were probably not really trained and probably, were drinking under the table anyway, and a technology that was not up to speed. So Fukushima was a disaster that could not be dismissed as easily. And so hopefully going forward, the idea is that we will anticipate more combinations of factors that might lead to a disaster and be more, the buzzword is resilient and nimble to deal with these issues. But the problem is that we can never anticipate all of these combinations. So I suspect, and I would side with Professor Perrow here, I think there is, if we continue to use nuclear power, there's going to be more accidents, and either we decide not to use nuclear power for that reason, if we consider it too risky, or we go on and develop emergency response procedures that actually work, and work faster and more effectively. Thank you.
So now I'd like all the panelists to come forward, and we're going to have just about half an hour or so discussion before opening the floor to Q&A. Rebecca is going to moderate our conversation.
So we are open to questions. I have several questions that I can certainly pose. I'll mention just a couple of them, not so much to dominate, but to hopefully open up our conversation a little bit. One is that Professor Perrow has argued that the accident at Three Mile Island was normal, whereas the disaster, meaning it was a systemic failure resulting from complex socio-technical systems, whereas the disaster at Fukushima was the result of a corrupt system. And are there nonetheless similarities that we can find when we're thinking about the causes of disasters at these three different places? Are these completely different cases, or are there similarities between them? Similarly, since Professor Schmid has been thinking about responses to nuclear emergencies, do these different disasters have common lessons to teach about how we respond to nuclear emergencies? To what extent do those responses need to be modified to adapt to local cultures and conditions and political differences? Can nuclear power ever be safe enough, right? That's sort of the big question, I think, that a lot of people are asking, given the reality of imperfect organizations and imperfect governance systems everywhere in every country around the world throughout all of history. Can it ever be safe enough, given those problems? And if so, could a sort of fail-safe governance system, if it could be designed, could it work in any country? Or would we really need to see major political changes in our current countries? And then the final question I think that we could think about is, when the costs of accidents are included in the cost of nuclear power, is it still less expensive than the renewable energy sources such as solar or wind, which are often said to be more expensive than nuclear power? So those are some questions that we can think about. I don't know if anybody wants to take a stab at that while I develop a list of questions. If you want to choose one and say something about it, and while you do that, why don't I go ahead and just start keeping a list? I'll just take a list of names, or someone has names of people out in the audience. Do you have any responses?
I think the Three Mile accident was a so-called normal accident. That is, nobody did anything wrong. Everybody played their part. Everybody trained hard. Everybody tried really hard, and it still went down because of the complexity of the system and the tightly coupled type of.
Can you speak, please, to the microphone closer?
Okay, I wasn't aware that you couldn't hear. Sorry, it was a normal accident because everybody tried very hard to do everything right, and it still went wrong because of the complexity of the system and its tight coupling. So that does not apply, however, to the two other nuclear accidents, and does not apply in general to the near misses that we have. In those cases, people haven't tried hard, haven't worked hard, haven't used the best knowledge, and so they have let things slip, and you can't do that with a complex system like this. In the last month, we've had four cases of nuclear power plants in the U.S. leaking tritium, which is not good for you, into the rivers, bays, lakes, and ocean. There's two of them in New York State, one in Vermont, and one in Florida, where this has gone on. This is because of poor maintenance practices, of not testing as often they should. They will have a finger wagged against them by the Nuclear Regulatory Commission, and maybe even a trivial little fine might be paid. But this is the basis on which we are going to get most of our nuclear power accidents, from small things like that that were not attended to. It's not going to take tsunamis to bring down the next nuclear power plant. But one final thing. I'm really amazed, because I have expected many more serious nuclear power accidents than we have had in the 50-some years that they have been going. They are in undeveloped countries with poorly trained staff, without a technological culture like Japan or the U.S. has, or Russia, and they keep going on and working. So it's maybe pretty hard to have a serious accident in a nuclear power plant, and that's puzzles me.
So, Dr. Byrne, I actually come from the climate change side of things, so I was actually surprised by Professor Perrow's comments on nuclear power, that producing baseload for zero carbon emissions was not one of the main things that you mentioned as a reason for building new plants. I was actually talking Tuesday with the person chair of the Commission for California Air Resources Board on meeting California's greenhouse standards, and she is absolutely convinced that it's not possible with current technology to meet zero carbon emissions without nuclear power. So just wondering if anyone wanted to comment on that.
Well, I'm not an expert on climate change or renewables and how nuclear fits in there, but that's certainly the argument that the nuclear industry has been making, that renewables that work now, like solar and wind, produce intermittent electricity, and nuclear provides baseload electricity. I think the picture is more complicated if you look at smart grids and decentralized generation and put that into the mix. Although with the discussion about small modular reactors that is ongoing at the highest DOE levels to this very day, this might be something that the nuclear industry is also trying to address. So, yeah, I don't know.
When the whole cycle is taken into account, and especially uranium mining and shipping of uranium, nuclear power does not turn out to be as zero contaminator as we think. That is, there's a lot of pollution that goes along with just manufacturing those huge vessels that they put in each plant. So there's that kind of thing. And then there's the emissions that come from uranium mining, which are serious. And then there's one more serious thing which gets almost no attention. We've had studies in France, Germany, and the U.S. that shows that if you live within a short distance, like 3 kilometers, of a nuclear power plant, your children's chance of getting radiation sickness, thyroid cancer especially, is 10 times as high as if you lived 100 miles away, the same kind of otherwise family situation. These plants have to burp every now and then. They have to let off radioactive steam in order to keep them running safe. And we have a government that says that low-level radioactivity, such as you get from these burps, is not harmful, not very harmful. So that's another cost that's not included in this. Of course, coal plants are much worse. There's no doubt about that. We shouldn't have coal at all. And we don't need to have coal at all.
Is this working? This microphone, I guess, working, right? I think that's a very important question. I think if we see the long range, and also in Japan, I think smart grid has not been really implemented. So I have been that the monopoly of utilization has to be dissolved. So like smart, so in my principle, at least in Japan, without no nuclear over the last 4 years, at least we could survive. But the principle of Japanese, I think I wrote, is decentralized electric sort of power company, decentralized first, and then renewable as much as possible in that local situation, like geothermal, maybe solar, could be wind, even current, sea current in the waves, other things, many things. I think in Scotland they are doing a lot of things. And then visualizing energy expenditure with new technology, with smartphone, all the things, I think that could be done and change the mindset. And California, they're using nuclear, but I think they are doing a lot of smart grid thing with Enron and many new devices of IT. And I think so they change the mindset of utilization and also selling and other things. So change the mindset of this conservation is a very important element. I think we should do maximum of this new technology, which conducive to many innovations through internet and also the smartphone, and I think there's many new innovations coming up. At least that's the Japan's issue.
Okay, thank you. Next question. Aloha, my name is Linda Kaufman. I think I wrote to most of you. Sonja, I had a question for you about Chernobyl, because I know there's a lot of young people in the audience who maybe don't have an idea of the scope of that accident. So I was trying to get a sense, when you look on the internet, there's such wildly different estimates. So I'm wondering, through your research, if you could give people a sense of what you found, the scope of, you know, mutations of thyroid cancer, of the impact of the accident, if you could just give a sense for those people who maybe don't know. Thank you.
Disappoint you, I'm not going to make that mistake and dabble in a field that I know nothing about. I'm not an expert in medical consequences of radiological exposure. I can tell you that the only direct cancer that is recognized as being associated with the Chernobyl disaster, and that's a big hedge, I realize, is thyroid cancer in children. And pretty nasty thyroid cancer in children, so not the standard variety that we occasionally occurs in this country and elsewhere. But according to Olga Kuczynskaya's book, Rebecca, do you know the title? Something invisible, the politics of invisibility. I'm sorry. She actually documents using the Belarusian example of scientists investigating specifically the medical consequences. And Belarus was the one Soviet republic that was affected most by the fallout, the immediate fallout of the explosion at Chernobyl. How they were fighting to establish even thyroid cancer as a recognized consequence. I did not know that because, you know, nowadays this is kind of, everybody admits that, you know, thyroid cancer in children is a consequence or is recognized as a consequence of Chernobyl. Apparently, that was not always so. And there are scientists who work on other forms of cancer and other, medical conditions to get that same status as recognized, as directly linked to the Chernobyl disaster.
Can I? No, that was the reason this next month is the 30th year of Chernobyl accident, right? Next month. That 30 years ago, maybe we may not have enough sort of detectors and science and technology to analyze all the things and early detection. Now we have it more or less, like genetics and many things and biomarker, everything. But that is the reason I think Japanese government has to be more open and transparent and sharing the experience with the rest of the world so that at least if something happens in next accident somewhere, at least we have some idea what kind of thing could be done. And if we do that just with Japanese institution, university and research and government, I mean, something may happen. So I think that has to be more like international collaboration, and Japanese government has to take an initiative. Let's follow this radiation exposure, what may happen. But I don't see that attitude. That is a problem with the Japanese government. So you push and do that. And I say there may be other funding, but I think the Japanese government have to initiate such a thing, like ABCC or Wave Bomb Hiroshima. That was sort of US armies. But I think at least in this hyper-connected, high-technology world in Japan, I mean, they should do that. I have been pushing this thing, but nobody listened.
If I could just
yes.
comment on that. I think the technology to measure, to document, yeah, to right. monitor was available after Chernobyl, and it was documented. But the problem is not whether you have the technology or not, but how you use it and whether you actually, you know, write your doctor's report with the, you know, what kind of instructions you get from above to put in yeah. the patient report, for example.
No, I understand that. But at that time, all Russian is sort of Soviet Union. So that's sort of everybody claims and this and that. But now, in this time of hyper-connected and internet and Japanese government, why they don't do that? Because we don't want to repeat these things, and we want to have more scientific database. So this is a sort of making this lesson into not to go to waste. That's what Winston Churchill said. Never let a good crisis go to waste. That's what it is.
Okay, thank you. Our next question, and I'm keeping my eyes open, so lift your hand if you have a question.
My question is fundamental to Professor Kurokawa.
Yes.
My name is Muawiya Barazengi. I'm a seismologist. And of course, this is not a place to discuss scientific aspect of the catastrophe. However, there's a need to discuss the problem of the siting of these orb and the ill-advised. You touched a little bit on that. However, I would like you to reflect on the long-range effect of if you stop completely using nuclear energy in Japan, the long-range and the substitute, and the impact on using, obviously you have to use more hydrocarbon, and since I don't think it's possible in the short term to have renewable energy to substitute for all of Japan. And so I would like your personal opinion and reflection in the long term, since there's no chance for Japan to have a hydrocarbon of its own, and has the power.
But also I think many countries, including Japan, in particular, decreasing aging society and decreasing population, unless they just change certain immigration law or whatever, and rapidly changing now total population. They aged, one out of four Japanese are 65 or older, and there's 50,000 centenarians, and what kind of industry and economy, I think, with society we're going to face is a serious issue. So in the future, more demand for energy may become less. I'm not so sure, but at least prediction of the IT, 50% of future energy is used for this internet and also servers and this communication thing. And whether this decreasing and very aging society, whether in the long term, to how much energy source we need is, I'm not so sure. At least in my pushing, we should use smart grid formation, more localized energy, more renewable, as much as possible.
Thank you.
and maybe visualizing energy expenditure to anybody. So I think that is the sort of the minimum. And some argument, nuclear could be more like smaller size, and that also may be a more better target for a terrorist attack. That may be another issue of such a fragile world. So what do we do? Just only, not only global warming is a major issue, but also terrorist attack, very unstable world, how to protect nuclear plants existing already. So these are the major issues, I think. So I think we have to communicate and share all these discussions with the public and also like global audience.
Do you have information how much more hydrocarbon you have to use the best for you?
I don't know. Since this accident, import of oil in Japan, like 100% import, was declined by 20%, and the import of LNG increased by 20%. Price of electricity went up very higher, much higher, but because of the primary due to weaker yen. And I think just we have to really visualizing and sharing all the information with the public, so which kind of choices they would like to do. And there's a lot of resistance to make more smart grid formation much, much faster, because this is a good investment for Japan. But somehow there's some resistant party in it. So just I don't see much of a change at the moment.
Hi, my name is Lisa Sansusi. I work in the Language Resource Center here. I want to thank you all so much for a very interesting panel and for sharing your perspectives. I have a couple of questions about Fukushima and nuclear power in general. So first of all, in relation to Fukushima, my understanding is that one of the basic problems is that the backup generators were at sea level, which strikes me as a really easy problem to resolve. So first I'm wondering how many other plants in Japan are in that situation and have the generators been moved? My second question is, I understand that, I think it's GE and Toshiba are developing a prototype of modular nuclear generators, or, that can be made on site and then shipped out. And I think the idea is that these would become economically viable over time with economies of scale. But right now, the prototype is extremely expensive. I think it's over $1 billion to spend and invested in developing this. And I understand also that the one of the problems they're running into is actually how to move them. Once you make the module, how to move it safely to a new site. So two questions, one about the diesel generator, backup generators, and then also the viability of a modular reactor. Thank you.
Second, viability, I'm not so sure, like, see what happens, how safe that may be. And that is acceptance by the greater public is a very important element. But second, there's about now 48 nuclear plants in Japan. I think they want to restart. But are we really learning the lesson from Fukushima thing? As you said, I think that was in session nine in this commission meeting, we asked a question to this new bureaucrats who is responsible, this nuclear safety guy. And I told him, just we are about 50 of them. Why don't you just list everything? When this was built, what is the model? And what is the historical earthquake and tsunami over millennia? And why don't you just make all this measurement and make it public? So which is the safer one relative to others? And this is not deficient in this sort of generator, all the things. Why don't you make it open? Just list everything in 20. And he just couldn't answer. I repeated this question. He couldn't answer because his mindset is such that I don't know. So I always say, just you are the judge. That's the reason I made everything on the record. You can watch this. Oh, this is ahead of this guy? I mean, that's crazy. So I never commented anything. Just you are the one to judge. So the core message is, this kind of elite who carry a responsible post, they are so forgetful in certain questions. Why is it? So these are the questions I pose. So just why don't you see, that was, I'm sure, commission session nine. So you might see the last maybe 10 minutes or so. You enjoy that too.
I'll look, thank you.
Yeah, thank you.
Okay, thank you. I have Vincent on my question list next, but I think I've lost track of where he is.
I'm over here.
Thank you. Sorry, I'm looking in the wrong
place. Yeah, I'm Vincent Galenti. I'm a PhD student in anthropology here at Cornell. And I did a study of Finland's nuclear energy sector, which has had a very different experience with nuclear power than some of the situations we've heard about today. So I'm trying to, I guess I have two questions. One would be, how do you interpret what some people see as nuclear energy success stories? For example, Sweden decarbonized its energy sector in a very serious way in 2 decades. It went from oil to fissioning uranium rather quickly. It didn't even know it was really doing it. This happened in the 70s, and now they find out that, you know, this has been quite good for Finland's emissions. So is there a place in the world today where nuclear energy makes sense? For example, Sweden has a few big earthquakes. They have a relatively low terrorism threat. They have a stable, highly educated society, and they have skirted bedrock where you can put nuclear waste after. So are there any places where the nuclear does make sense, even though it seems like a bad idea from what I hear from these presentations? The other question is, what about someone like Bill Gates, who invests money in sort of TerraPower, this Generation 4 reactors, like the small modular reactors that were just brought up? How do you respond to people who say, you know, we're not in favor of Generation 1, 2, and 3 nuclear reactors. We think we should close down all existing centralized big nuclear energy plants, but we still want to invest tons of money in R&D for future nuclear stuff, future Generation 4 reactors. So these people would be against nuclear as it exists today, but would want to invest lots of R&D to support future designs of nuclear reactors, such as small modular reactors or thermal or fast reactors or something, or thorium. How do you respond to that?
Me? You?
No.
Okay, I'll take a stab at those. So first of all, the nuclear success stories, I think that's a great question, but I don't think that it's limited to us today assessing where it made sense or makes sense or not. That's what I meant with taking the longer historical perspective, because if you look at the countries that developed nuclear power programs, and I'm thinking of, Eastern European countries, for example, Central and Eastern European countries, it made a lot of sense at the time. They got technical assistance for relatively cheap from the Soviet Union, even they had to push and pull and everything. And they could replace their very dirty coal plants with modern and what was considered very progressive and cutting-edge technology that was not only, a sign of technical progress, but also a sign of social progress. So what counts as success, I would argue, is very context-dependent and historically situated. So that's one thing. What I was trying to do in my book is show why nuclear power made sense in the Soviet Union. Because if you look at the Soviet Union, they had so many natural resources that at first you would think, well, why on earth would they even, develop nuclear power? True, they had a weapons program, so it was kind of a byproduct in the first place. But at the same time, if you look at the distribution of resources and demand, you also realize that the resources were, Far East and Siberia, and the demand was in the western part. So it did make sense when you dig a little deeper. On the small modular reactors, I mean, I could talk for a long time about those, but I think even industry representatives would agree that the current fleet of nuclear power reactors that are operating are very inefficient. They're products of their time. We didn't know any better at the time. And there are new designs out there that could probably perform better. The problem is, and this is, from the outset in the nuclear industry, do you stick with what you know and standardize what you know and can control, or do you modify, innovate, change, and implement something that you don't know and that potentially might result in dangerous issues? And that tension is apparent no matter where you look, and also in this debate.
One thing I think I'd like to make a comment to you is, I think, are we really willing to learn from this accident. That is the thing. That may be more political and economic and many factors of this thing. Now, after Fukushima, what kind of lesson we like to share? One is, I think, at least Japanese are reasonably, economically reasonably advanced. Technology is good. So why don't we share all the radiation and long-term follow-up, and just why don't we do that with the international community? That's I'm really suggesting. And second is, look at airline industry. You know, like nuclear plants is produced by GE, Hitachi, and Westinghouse, and Toshiba, and Arriva, Mitsubishi Heavy, and maybe four or five different manufacturing companies, just airline, like Boeing and Lockheed and Airbus, and you buy it. If you buy this thing, that becomes national airline, right? And how their sort of pilots, engineers communicate each other, even national airlines, they fly overseas. And they have to communicate with a common language of English. They are landing and this and that, right? So why not apply this principle in this nuclear thing? When I was giving this MIT, and there's many sort of nuclear experts to be from some Nigeria, few other countries, and who are sure their operation and regulation is reasonably par with others. And they could just buy this thing and build this in your country. But how do we know? Because in the globalization, you just cannot hide the thing. So that my suggestion, also I made it to Tanaka-san, who is the new sort of head of safety commission. Or why don't you send sort of maybe 30 Japanese, like younger generation of regulators to US, 20 to France, and 10 to UK, and 10 to Sweden, and then the same number just exchange. Once you start exchanging this regulators and operators, I think they become incorporating into better practices, and the communication become not a Japanese, but English most likely, or maybe Google Translate, Watson, they can do that whatever you speak. But at least you know, oh, this guy knows a lot of things, and this guy knows. So I think this, they are sharing better practice. So and then I think once you build this operation in Nigeria or somewhere, at least I think we are creating international licensing of regulators and operators, and they have to go through recertification every 3 years or something. And I think that kind of thing is a more constructive, at least assuring global community. Because unless you follow this kind of pilot and regulators, I know even some countries' national airline just cannot light somewhere. So that is a way to just make the world at least safer, even this nuclear to be sort of implemented. So I think that's my suggestion. But I think Japanese government is not saying it. Even I knew that. But also perhaps what would be the best country to start saying this kind of thing? Operators and regulators exchange program for maybe 2-3 years so they communicate each other and become more transparent. And I think I suggested maybe Canada and Sweden maybe propose such a thing for this international exchange for future operators and regulators. So become a sort of uniformal operation.
We are slightly over our time, but I have 4 questions left. So what I'm going to do, which is cool and unusual, is ask each person who has a question to state their question, don't answer, and then if you'd like to take a shot at answering whatever way you want. That's
great. And you're
about to go. I hope
that
you can save the final question. And please
introduce
yourself.
So thank you very much. My name is Yuki Mizutani. I'm an MBA student at Cornell. I have a question for Dr. Kurokawa, which is how can people in Japan change the unique social norms? I worked for the Japanese government before coming here, so I am very familiar with things you mentioned earlier. So I'm wondering how people can change their behavior. Thank you.
I am not working for Japanese government. Because my sponsor was the first time in the democratic constitution of Japan. This is the first time, which is quite norm in many countries. But I think that's the reason I said people, for the people of Japan and for the people of the world. That is the mission is for. So I'm not representing Japanese government.
Your answer for the moment.
Right. Thank you.
You mentioned the connectedness of the world. This also means not only can you get information out, you can get misinformation out very quickly.
Sure.
So we could put together a panel from any energy source here and have a discussion about what is wrong with that energy source and have 1,000 people tell us why it's a disaster if we call that group, including renewables. So how do we sort out what the real risks are? How do we weigh a risk of mercury tritium versus sea level rise if we don't convert to nuclear power?
Thank you very much.
I'm Tim Mount, a applied economist. I wanted to follow up on the last statement that was made by our keynote speaker. The French have actually got a pretty good nuclear program, and they have done things very differently from the US. They had a fairly standardized design. They didn't depend on competition. They reprocess their fuel so they don't have to dig up so much uranium. Have they done it right, or have they just been lucky?
Hi, Josh McGowan from the Cornell East Asia Program. And my question, I guess, Dr. Kurokawa somewhat answered it in his ending speech, but it might be for Professor Schmidt, which is this matter of regulatory capture and particularly academics. And what I'd like to know is, from your perspective, what does that look like with an international training, international academic research based in for the nuclear industry, and yet everything is nationally based? And so I'd like to know what that looks like.
All right, so please, if you take whatever question you would like to answer, and close the comment.
Me? I think in this hyper-connected world, the principle of the trust, it become transparent and sharing, because this is not a, this is a global issue. And also, I think in the world is changing very rapidly. Germany now starting sort of industry 4.0. Why 4.0? Because they just had this changing industry revolution to this and that. But industry 4.0 means beginning of the internet. That's starting from 1970. And you just cannot hide things, because we have an iPhone, we are videotaped, and also like recorded without any permission. So in essence, I think transparency is a foundation of trust, any organization or individual or government. And in fact, this is, in my view, the beginning of the end of nation state, which is based on the European Westphalia thing. You know, like even Scotland want to be independent. Why is that? Czechoslovakia was there 20 years ago, but it's gone. So why is it? I mean, so the corporate become global, right? So why Pfizer want to buy some company in this Iceland or just Ireland? Because this corporate tax is cheaper. When Pfizer want to buy AstraZeneca, there's a big political issue between US and UK because of taxing. And Google raised a lot of revenue in UK, but they are not paying that much tax. So I think that is the thing. The end of nation state control is very become limited. NGO become sort of global. So Medicine Sans Frontières is French bomb, but nobody cares about French entity. And also academic institution, research institution become global. They like to attract global talent and also produce many global talent. I think who cares about, so you, many US universities like Cornell attracting a lot of global talent and produce many global talent. So national entity become less of importance in governance. So like government want to control, but talent become global too. So like nuclear, if this is a common source of very important element of energy, for this climate change and battle disaster, why not exchange this with regulators and operators? And producer could be, you know, like could belong to any nation. So national entity become less of relevant, and that is the reason many countries do not allow breakaway, do not allow this or that, because they are afraid of this globalization and public awareness of different things of different countries. So nuclear thing, I really like to have sharing this lesson with the rest of the world, radiation thing, long-term follow-up, supported not only by Japanese government, but I think many sort of concerned citizens and some of big foundation like Gates, and also operators and regulators have to go to more like international and also licensing and exchange program from the scratch. I mean, Japan should do that, but I think they are not willing to do that. Then just why not start somewhere else?
Could I just make an observation that's been missing from this interesting discussion? Fukushima accident is not over,
right.
Not by any means.
Yes.
It's going to go on for maybe 40 years. The cancer rate in Japan is going to rise steadily. It's going to be denied by the government because there's no transparency on this issue in Japan. There's a particular example of the problem that intrigues me is when they put the plant in, and they not only dug it out so it'd be closer to the water source of the sea, but they put it where there was a river flowing underneath that area.
Right.
But they went up the hill and they diverted the river so that it flew down on the sides of the large area there, and that was no problem. They never anticipated that an earthquake could wreck their diversion. So now we have a strong underground river flowing directly under the plant where three huge globs of molten fuel are sitting on the bottom, giving off radiation and sending that radiation to the water, to the river that's underneath the plant, and it's going out to the ocean, and we're seeing damage of marine life in the western west coast of U.S. and British Columbia, and there's no way that that's going to be stopped until they get the molten cores out of there, and they have no way that they know of doing that. Nobody has any idea what to do about the continuing Fukushima contamination.
Thank you for your comment. In fact, I thought Japanese government has an open proposal for request for proposal in last maybe September or so. The deadline was like only 3 months or so, 3 weeks or so, which is crazy. But at least how to just reduce contaminated water, like 1,000 tons each day and contaminating like 300, 400 tons of water from upstream. And they sort of, that formality again, they received about 750 sort of proposals and 200 from abroad, which they did sort of effort to show they are willing to just open up and request a proposal. But they haven't shown what kind of proposal came in. So I called the head of this nuclear agency, which I know him very well. I'm sure there's at least one or two, because I know somebody submitted this thing, diversion of this upstream, and so that plant itself become eventually dry land, because water coming through, diversion of this water. There's such a thing, I knew. So I think, what's going to happen with this thing? And I think all of a sudden, a few months later, they raise, we're going to do this in freezing land. Most expensive, energy intensive. Yeah. Stupid? So why is it? Why they could be so stupid? That's my question. Because any proposal has to be cheap and reasonably faster, and downstream become dry, so it's much easier to work on this debris thing, and technology become available, and cost. Its diversion is in the long term, it's much, much easier. You don't need high tech. So I told him, I know there's such a proposal, but why they are not showing what kind of proposal came in, what kind of combination would be the best way, and then they announce, oh, this is the way we're going to try this. That is a foundation of trust and transparency, and that diversion is there. That's a very simple one. Don't you think? Just upstream? Absolutely. They don't want that. They want to spend more money. Public money.
Yeah, I wanted to take a stab at the question, how do we figure out what the real risks are? Because it ties in with some of the questions that Rebecca had posed in the beginning. Can nuclear power ever be made safe enough? I think ultimately, the question is not so much can we find out what the real risk is, but who gets to define what risk we prioritize and we focus on. And so the question of nuclear then becomes a question of democracy and ultimately a question of justice. Who gets to say something, and whether we entrust these decisions to governments and technocrats, or how, if we decide to do so, we actually democratize the process. And it's challenging no matter how you plan to go forward. But I think that's the ultimate lesson of this, that we can no longer have technocrats, scientists, and engineers in charge defining the real risk and then solving it, and the rest of the population just watches and has no impact whatsoever on these questions or how they are being addressed.
Okay, well, thank you. And I'd like to say a few things before we close. I think we have kind of two important sort of takeaway points from my point of view. One, I think just to commemorate the 50th year anniversary of this disaster in Fukushima, I think it is important for us to acknowledge that the crisis in Fukushima is ongoing. This is actually an important point we should remind ourselves. And so the second point is, I think the nuclear energy is a really complex and really highly contextualized issue that really in turn calls for an equally complex and highly contextualized solution and response. And that really demands really truly international, really transnational, collaborative, and interdisciplinary and sustained work. And in that spirit, I know the center is hosting a series of events on this issue this year. In May, on May 3rd, we're going to have a land critical debate on this very question. Is nuclear the answer to climate change? We have invited two speakers, Daniel Kamen from UC Berkeley and Lauri Molanen from the Finnish Energy Council. So please come to join the debate. And on September 12th, the fall, we have Henry E. and Nancy Horton Baltel's World Affairs Lecture by Svetlana Alexievich, winner of the 2015 Nobel Prize in Literature. She has written extensively on crisis of her lifetime, from the war to the nuclear disaster in Chernobyl. So she's going to deliver a public lecture on September 12th. And I also like to note that this initiative, Einaudi Center's initiative, Nuclear Energy, is a collaboration between the center and the REPI Institute for Peace and Conflict Studies. It's a really world center in the study of nuclear non-proliferation, and also a collaboration with the Meridian 180 project in the Cornell Law School, which has developed an international working group on the technical and economic and political dimensions of nuclear energy. And finally, we would like to thank all who contributed to this inaugural event. And particularly, I thank members of the Centers for Foreign Policy Network for their guidance and support. And I also want to thank Rebecca for working with me really closely in planning this event and this whole series for this year. And also I need to thank the center's longstanding sponsors and fans, Luigi and Carol Einaudi and the Baltels family and Julia Lund Briggs, for their generous support. And I also like to take this opportunity to thank my staff, Nishi Dupa, Heike Michelson, and our brand new staff member, John Miller, and as well as staff writer for the VPIA's office, Linda Kopman, who wrote a group of stories on nuclear energy and center's engagement with this issue for our website. Please visit our website for that fascinating group of stories. And also like to thank Vice Provost for International Affairs, Lois Fitz, and Jerry Wall, Director of Communication in that office, for actually making Linda available to us. And so with that note, I'd like to thank you all for coming today. And this is just the beginning of a longer conversation and collaboration. And so I'll see you again, hopefully in May, on May 3rd, in the debate, Lund Critical Debate on Nuclear Energy. And thank you all, panelists, today for joining us today.